So Lord Iltari has a subscribe star also known as the Paladin. I would really recommend anyone who's invested in this story to go over and check it out. It's a solid way to help support the author and help get stories like this written. So check out the top link in the description. Though let's start, will we? Be me, Paladin. Be Castor, Julian, Undri, Senkit, Eort, and Peregrine. Paladin's currently smelling of sewage, hiding from a rather large number of angry hyena people in a hidden thief's den in the sewers of San Jonas. Not exactly the most glorious of days they're having here. Worse yet, they're not alone in their hiding place. There is a small tunnel in the wall of the den, and several sets of eyes are watching the paladins, who watch back as hissing mutterings whisper from the hole. Castor, much to his own surprise, can understand them, as can Julian, as the creatures are speaking to one another in a crude dialect of Draconic. Strangers, dangerous, should run and collapse. No, there's a Dragonson here, another emissary of the Burning Lord perhaps. We cannot be rude here. Small one. Is it a gnome? We should kill it, just to be sure. No Sylvester, that's a halfling. Maybe one of the ladies folk? There's an elf here too, a living one, that's got to be it. Don't like the other ones, they smell like the Brimstone House, especially that cat. Bast apparently understands that last comment, and hisses at the creature irritably. Dragonson here. We are going to talk with him. You're right, Yuga. The last sound is frustrated as a small creature exits the hole and bows low before Castor. The creature is roughly the same size and build as Peregrine, small but very well built, covered in mottled green scales, save for around his head and eyes, where the scales are an unusually bright silver, far more brilliant than anywhere else on his or her, hard to tell with reptile's body. Kaz looks at that unique marking and wonders, for he has never seen a kobold with markings that brilliant before. It is clearly a knight of some description, for it wears a crude suit of scavenged scale mail. It carries a spear that was clearly made for someone twice their size and was then cut in half, and what would be a normal-sized shield for anyone else. But for this small creature is practically a tower shield. Greetings, O Great One. It greets Gaz and Draconic. What brings you to the outskirts of the humble den of the Silver Crowns tribe? Castor looks at the kobold still bowing low before him and concentrates before speaking. His voice is clear but slow, yet noble. It's clear just how much effort he's putting into not allowing his trademark accent to creep in. Arise, little one. I do not know of this burning lord of whom thou speaks. I am Castor Glaimdring, and these are my companions and friends, even the elf. We are paladins and have traveled here from far to the south, and sought this room as refuge from the ravening hordes of the hyena folk. We had no foreknowledge of thine dwelling place, and bear thou no ill will nor malice. He speaks, and Julian's eyebrows raise. Ye gods, he really is a prince, he mutters to himself in Celestial, chuckling inwardly at the contrast between this eloquent nobleman and Kaz's coarse common. Well then welcome nonetheless, Lord Glaimdring. The kobold responds as he raises his head. I am Kolyurik. Behind me are my companions on this watch, Sylvester and Meeple. My apologies for their rudeness. It is of no matter, I shall not hold a grudge for thine caution. I would escort you to the usual entrance we have hidden for taller guests, but I am afraid that the route that is currently rather, filled with a giant horde of baying cannibals. So that is rather inadvisable. If you are willing to wait, I will inform the chief of your arrival immediately. Alternatively, the tunnel may fit you if you were to crawl. I believe that it may be wisest to depart, merely due to the possibility that one of those, as you so perfectly put it, baying cannibals, manages to catch a scent through the stench and decides to bash down the wall. It is unlikely, but I find the possibility stronger if we were to remain standing here awaiting audience. Very well, sir. Your halfling companion may wish to produce a torch as we have none except in the audience hall. Of course, and let us depart post haste. It is so very rude to leave a man of such stature as a chieftain waiting, and I do not wish there to be any hostilities between the two of us. Julian is very glad he's still wearing his helmet. It makes it much easier for him to conceal his huge grin and stifle his chuckles. Right then, lads and lassies, we're going to go and see their chieftain. We need to cause any trouble for the wee lizards, and Peregrine, we may need a torch. Peregrine nods as he taps his tunic and it lights up with a soft golden glow, like a warm hearth. lead the way, he says with a smile to Yrike, as well as Sylvester and Meepo, who are shielding their eyes, unused to the light. The kobolds turn and lead the party through the twisting maze of tunnels. Khazad-dûm brings up the rear, and Undri stays rather close to Senkit, muttering to herself in Elvish. I hate tight spaces, I hate tight spaces, I hate tight spaces, she says. But considering she's had her worst fear thrown at her the other day, so she puts things in perspective and soldiers on. After a couple minutes of uncomfortable crawling and several stares from many other kobolds, guys in particular receiving the most, the party emerges into a broad central room tall enough for them to stand upright, though Khaz is still close enough to the roof that he has to duck under roots in the ceiling. Here they can see dozens of kobolds coming and going, each busy with one task or another, save for a few particularly small ones, who dash about throwing a ball as big as their heads. Kobold hatchlings, probably no more than a year old. The tiny race certainly grows quickly. Most bow low as Khazad-dûm passes, and then quickly get back to their work, chattering to one another in their chirping dialect. From here the paladins follow Yrike through another large tunnel, this one clearly sized for humans and other such sized creatures, into a slightly smaller room with a throne at one side, clearly stolen from some great house or another. This room is lit by torches and has a large exit with a heavy door that can be barred from this side, clearly meant for meetings with larger folk. Guys and the others approach the throne and bow lightly in respect. While not exactly all of equal opinion about the tiny dragonoids, even the stubbornest among them knows it's a bad idea to piss them off while still in the midst of their lair. Sat in the throne is an aged kobold, easily the oldest that any of them have seen, and also one of the most unusual. All her scales are silver, save the crown atop her head that shines brightly enough that Khazad-dûm's suspicions are confirmed now that he has contrast. These kobolds might call their crowns silver, but platinum might be a better moniker. Now he was curious. Greetings, great one, and greetings to your companions, she says, bowing her head slightly. Sylvester ran ahead and informed me of your coming, though I have sensed that you would arrive soon enough, she says with a smile. Thou wert informed of our coming? Thou must possess then spies of the lightest feet and swiftest shadow, for we did not even suspect there might be kobolds within the city, or within these summer lands at all. You flatter me, but if I had spies like that I would have found a better throne. The matriarch jokes. Noble of speech and of bearing, you're definitely not the burning brat's kin. But my mind wanders, no. The dragon informed me that one who might be one of his sons was coming, and I suspect that's you. I am Nee Dragon's son, Khazad-dûm responds, and his accent slips in. The matriarch looks at him for a moment and then laughs. No, you're a dwarf, ha! And one very good at playing down that accent of yours when your temper isn't roused, I must say, she says, still chuckling. Save it for when you're talking to a real dragon, Sonny, and not just an old coot who outlived hers. Julian inwardly sighs in relief as he will no longer have to control his giggle fits from Khaz's posh UN accent. And, let's not be rude and keep this conversation to us, eh? My common isn't as good as it used to be, but I still own it, the matriarch says, switching to common. I am Sigun, chieftain of the Silver Crowns. If you remain at peace with us, we will remain at peace with you. Peregrine steps forwards. Now that the conversation is one he can understand, the diplomatic halfling takes over for Khaz. A pleasure to meet you, Madam Chief. I am Peregrine, and this is Khazad-dûm, Undri, Senkit, Julian, and the Ort. We are the Paladins of Order Undivided, come from the south to aid in the restoration of the Summer Lands. Restoration, eh? Unless you're all true dragons in disguise, I highly doubt the six of you alone are going to be restoring much of this wreck. No, at least I know I'm not one. Don't think any of the others are either. But we aren't here to take back the city, at least not yet. We are here looking for information on where the other major cities and holy sites in this region were. And why would you need that? We mean to cleanse the blight. The ancient kobold looks at him, and blinks twice. You really mean it, don't you? How do you know what the blight is and still think you can destroy that thing? The ever-optimistic halfling responds with a grin. The gods will it. Why else would so many paladins wind up all in one place? Oh, you poor fool, Sigun says sadly. You have no idea what you're up against. The blight doesn't care any for whether your gods champion you or not. Even my mistress Archangel Steinfell against it. If a dragoness couldn't kill it, what hope do you have? The old kobold speaks as one who has once held hope and saw it utterly dashed. You couldn't even beat the gnolls, and you say you're going to kill the blight? Ha! We never said we would beat it today, Julian says, stepping forwards. As we said, we're not here for the city, we're here for information about where to find the dwarf and elven strongholds. We have a plan to stop the blight, but it isn't something we're foolish enough to think can be beaten just by hitting it with a sword a few times. So you're cleverer than you look. Yes, yes, and the dragon said to help you, so I shall. If you want information, you'd probably be best looking in the old hall. It's not far from the dragon's house. Ye mention a dragon, but did ye nee say that your dragoness was dead? Kazdor asks slightly suspiciously. Not my dragon, the dragon. The one who gave us our silver crowns and lives in the great house in the center of the city. The party is very confused by this statement, as they've seen no signs of any dragon, and giant flying lizards are hard to miss. Julian shakes his head, cleared it, and gets back on topic. What about the old university? We could look there as well. Sigun scowls. That is a foul place. Talk with Meeple. He went there several times, but after the last time we found him near that place, he was a babbling wreck for weeks. Otherwise, we can get you into the dragon's house fairly easily. We have an old tunnel there, and few go by. They can't take the dragon, it's too holy for them. The party looks at one another, vaguely wondering if this old kobold is ever so slightly off her rocker, but don't say anything. Thank you for the information, one moment please. Julian responds, and then the party turns to debate what to do next. I say we go and see who this dragon is they keep chatting about, and from there go to the old hall, Kazdor suggests. I'm not so sure, I believe we should prioritize the university. Julian counters. There's a vote held. Julian and Undri vote to investigate the university first, while the others vote to go and see about this dragon. Peregrine turns from the group and goes to speak with Sigun. We would greatly appreciate it if you could show us the way to the dragon's house, he says, and Sigun nods. Very well, Yurik will guide you to the right tunnel. He is very fond of the dragon and goes there regularly, she says, motioning to the dragon shield, who bows in acknowledgement. Thank you for this aid, Madam Chief, Peregrine responds, bowing in respect. The others follow suit, and the old kobold waves a hand to dismiss them. As they go, she closes her eyes and utters a soft prayer. You told me one who could be your son was coming, but he's a dwarf. And you told me a dragoness would come and protect us again, lead us somewhere better, but they're all just normal adventurers. I don't understand, she prays, and then opens her eyes as something touches her hand. She looks at it, and smiles as she sees a single canary yellow feather. The party follows Yurik through another set of winding tunnels before emerging in the basement of an old building. The place is clearly ancient, but not yet abandoned. Someone has been taking care to sweep away the dust and the spiders. Yurik leads them up a set of stairs, and as he leads ahead, the party can hear his footsteps begin to echo. Soon they emerge from a stair set into an alcove, into a marvelous and grand hallway. Long pillars strain heavenwards from a smooth marble floor to support a ceiling that nearly scrapes the heavens. Stained glass hang in the windows, though many panels are broken or otherwise diminished by age and dust. A balcony overhangs all around them, supported by lesser pillars engraved with tarnished gold. Images of heroes and of saints, with their names etched in draconic characters. But the greatest marvel of all stands at the altar. A gigantic statue of a dragon, so tall that its wings reach halfway up the ceiling, gilded in platinum, save for a shining brilliant scale on its breast, which even from this distance, shines like a star. The platinum scale emanates power, enough to make the party feel rejuvenated and courageous, and enough to set Julian's teeth buzzing. The dragon's house. Of course, this cathedral was dedicated to Bahamut, Undri exclaims, facepalming at how obvious it was now. Kazdor shifts uncomfortably. That explains the wee lizard's markings. Ardeniken, there were silver ones or ones for the god with the right number of heads for that matter. Most of the stories about kobolds are about troublemakers and trappers, not exactly the sorts to follow Bahamut, but they're more common than you'd think. If I remember right, around a quarter of every city in the realms is a kobold population that nobody ever thinks about because they keep to themselves, Peregrine says, looking about. I'm more concerned with that scale in particular, Julian says, shielding his eyes from its glow. I've got a sneaking suspicion that's why this place is still standing and undesecrated. Bahamut is a remarkably practical deity if nothing else. Wait, are you saying what I think you're saying? Senkit asks in awe. No clue what you're thinking. I dominate minds, not read them. But if you're thinking that's actually one of his scales, you might be right. He does have a habit of showing up on the mortal planes to help out, and I suppose he sheds like any other dragon. Yurik looks at them happily, pleased to see there is awed by the cathedral as he is. Come, come. I show you all the places, he chirrups. His common is poor and combined with his high voice it makes him sound like an excited child. He leads them by the images of the saints. Someone, probably him, has been busy working to clean off the images and try to restore them, though they're only really effective on the lower halves. These are all the dragons, the ones who save and protect others. Several of these images are most clearly not dragons, which leads to a bit of head scratching before Andre hits upon it. Of course, they worship dragons and look at them like we look at angels. Julian smirks. Well, most of us anyways, so calling someone a dragon must be equivalent to one of us calling someone a saint or an angel. Yurik nods enthusiastically and shows them around, eventually leading them up towards the balcony, but Kazdor lingers, looking up at the statue of Bahamut. Soon enough Julian stands beside him, looking up with a similar expression. You feel like you should feel something you're not feeling, aren't you? He asks the tall dragonborn. That's a good way of putting it, lad. It's like standing in a room that's just like yours, but it's not yours. It's someone else's. Ye feel like ye should belong and yet ye deny all at once. Yoken, more than you know. It's part of the reason I tend to avoid places like this. The angel's son responds, looking up at the altar. Though I really have to admire the craftsmanship and dedication that people put into these. Aye. Kaz responds, and they're silent for a long while. Ye Kenjals, ye probably could have taken a portal to Celestio and ye left them. Why didn't ye? You could have sought out a tribe of dragonborn, and probably been remarkably successful with them when you left your stronghold. Why didn't you? The two men stand there, an understanding and kinship passing between them as they look up at the altar of a god they feel they ought to know, but don't feel anything at all towards. Then they turn, look one another in the eye, and clasp hand to talon in a manly grip of mutual understanding and camaraderie. Then the paladins turn from the altar, and hurry to join the rest of the group. By the time the party is done touring the cathedral, it is starting to get late. They bed down in the cathedral for the night, still setting watches. During Julian's watch, he hears a tapping from the upper levels and goes to investigate. Up on the balcony he finds an old man turning the corner from another part of the building, clad all in grey and leaning heavily on a staff. Ah, hello there. The old fellow says with a wave. Who are you? What are you doing here? Julian asks warily. He's seen enough shapeshifters to know not to trust old men. Oh, I'm just an observer for now. As for what I'm doing here, this is my house. Do I ask you what you do in your home when I spend the night in it? HM? He asks in return, leaving the Arsimer slightly flabbergasted. Maybe I should ask what you're doing here, but I already know that, so it would be rather boring. Maybe instead I should ask why. I don't know that one. Why? What do you mean why? Why pick up that sword of yours? Why seek out all that knowledge to add to your collection? Why live on the mortal plane? Why fight so ferociously against chaos for the sake of common folk you'll never meet and who will never reward you? Why so much rage and drive to protect those close to you? Julian is taken aback by the barrage of questions, and he opens his mouth to speak, but the man raises a finger. I know, it's not just Baneth. I know your mother and her parenting alone doesn't account for all of it. Accident. Julian hisses as he goes for his sword, suspecting the man's identity. Wrong again, boy. Your father doesn't need to go through the trouble of disguising himself to talk to you, even if you have bent that magnificent mind of yours to tuning him out. I must admit though, you're either the angriest or the most courageous man I've seen if you were willing to draw your sword on Isola. Julian puts his sword back. Probably a bit of both, he responds. Courage and arrogance aren't too far apart. Goodness knows my children taught me that, let me tell you. But still, you're quite a bit like them. Arrogant or courageous, fiercely protective, hungry for power, and foolishly independent, the old man says, smiling. Just thought I'd drop in and tell you that since you're staying the night in my house, just do clean up after yourself. The old man turns to go. And do think on the why, Tiran. Be the man you wish to be, but don't hamstring yourself for silly reasons. The old man turns back around the corner, and Julian pursues him, still very confused. When he rounds the corner though, the man is gone. All that is there is a single canary yellow feather. Be me. Be Castor the noble, Eeyore the soldier, Peregrine the criminal, Julian the sage, Senkit the hermit, and Undri the acolyte. From many different backgrounds they come, but paladins one and all they are. The paladins awaken on the stone floor of the Cathedral of Bahamut in the center of Zanjonas. Julian decides to keep quiet about his strange encounter last night and ponders it further. The party begins to discuss their plans for the day. With us being so close to the city hall, we should start there. Senkit begins, and Castor nods. Aye, seems reasonable. Under most circumstances, I would agree, but I believe we should begin by clearing the Elven Glade. Undri counters, and the others look at her, slightly confused. Allow me to explain. As it stands at this moment, we are deep inside enemy territory, and any fight or encounter we engage in risks bringing a small army down on our heads. We got lucky last time, and even with Urag to show us the back ways and Peregrine being able to find the hidden rooms, we must be cautious. Furthermore, if we retreat and the enemy discovers us here, we cannot hold out against them. We are too few and the only retreat would bring the foe down upon our kobold allies. The elf explains frankly. We require a sanctuary, a place where the enemy will not dare to tread even in spite of numbers, and a place that even if they do attack we are able to escape the city from. This cathedral is a fine place, but it sits in the center of the city with no way out. The glade provides us several advantages. Firstly, it is terrifying to the enemy. Secondly, any foe that sees us flee there will assume that we will be slain by the banshees, and thus assume us dead, granting us an element of surprise. Thirdly, should the foe press us there in force, we can escape because it is so near to the walls. It is also large enough that should the kobolds be forced to evacuate, we could take them out by that path as well. Undri concludes. The others look at one another. It seems a good idea. Senkit raises a concern though. This all assumes that we can banish the banshees. I'm not exactly an expert on them, but fighting a horde of ghosts that can kill us all by screaming strikes me as a bad idea. You may not be experienced in dealing with the accursed, but I am. Undri counters. Furthermore, if I can reach the shrine of Selhedin there, I can perform the opening of the way and put them to rest once and for all. The what now? Castor asks, slightly confused. It's a ritual that priests of Selhedin can use to banish the restless elven dead. When an elf dies, they pass through the moon door to be rejoined briefly with Karelan Lathian and then be reborn. However, if an elf dies before their time, they can be trapped as a ghost. In particularly violent or cursed cases, a female elf will become a banshee. The opening of the way briefly opens the moon door on the mortal plane and allows the dead to pass on, assuming they want to. If they don't, we have other methods. Undri explains. What are the other methods? Julian asks curiously. Usually exorcism and banishment using certain words and phrases. The wicked dead are usually the ones who least want to leave, but their souls are still bound to Karelan, so destroying their form and link to the world is usually enough. If they aren't wicked, then it means dealing with their unfinished business and possibly therapy. Therapy for ghosts. Dying is a remarkably traumatic event. More often than you'd think, a ghost doesn't want to pass on either because they're scared or confused. Some don't even realize that they're dead. Children particularly, that was always the worst. They don't realize that they've died and don't even understand what death is. Explaining what happened and helping them come to peace with it is a fairly common way of helping them on their way. Undri explains like it's no big deal. The others stare at her. She looks back at them, confused at their stares. I am a priestess of a death god, not just some ranger. I had to deal with the dead almost as much as with the living, she says, crossing her arms and glaring at them crossly. It's ne that we forgo, it's that Arcane imagine ye sit in one of those big chairs with a ghost lying on a couch and ye asking it questions about their mother. Castor says, breaking into a bit of a chuckle. Undri chuckles with him, and then the whole party breaks down into grins and barely suppressed laughter at that particular image. Yeah, hey. Right, back on topic. Your point about the glade is a good one. While I don't like delaying our expedition to the university any more than we already have, we should make sure we have a haven and an exit strategy, Julian says, his face going back to all serious and businesslike. Right then, you're the expert on ghosts, what do we need to do? Kazdor asks. Peregrine, get some candles from around here, we'll need the wax to block out the banshee's cry. Senkit, find me the biggest basin you can. Julian, a water source to fill it. Eort, you go with Yurik and scout us out a route into the glade, we'll need to go in at night when the moon is high to pull this off. Last but not least, Kaz, she pulls out several silver coins, how is the grade on these? The dragonborn takes the coins, weighs them in his hands, sniffs them, and takes a lick of one. I'd say around 70% pure. Pretty solid stuff but watered down enough that they're durable and need too much bother to carry about. Why? Can you grind them down to powder? Andre asks, and Gus grins as he realizes what she's up to. Alas, though it'll take some time and I'll need more coins of this quality or higher. She tosses him the coin pouch, and he gets to work. Soon enough Senkit comes in with a huge bronze basin on her shoulders, set it before the altar. Andre directs. Julian comes back with two buckets, and the three get to work filling it from the nearby river. Peregrine comes by with fistfuls of candles. Got the candles. Excellent. Get them to Gaz and tell them to keep them close to his body to make sure the wax is soft. Andre orders him as she pours another bucket into the basin. Soon the basin is full to the brim. Kaz, how's the silver coming? I got it here lassie, but I'll need a wee bit longer to get it finished, maybe an hour or two. The dragonborn responds, faithfully grinding down the silver coins and collecting the powdered shavings. Maybe ye could take the time and tell us how ye wound up giving ghosts therapy while our work, eh? That is true, we didn't get your story, or yours either Sen. Peregrine offers as looks at Andre with a smile. The proud elf looks down as the grinning halfling and sighs, sitting down cross-legged as she begins to tell her story. I suppose I may as well, and some of what I did after getting to that point as well, or it would be a very short story. I was set on that path quite literally from birth. If my parents are to be believed, I was conceived the night the moonbow faded from the sky. The moonbow is a message from Selhaedin to inform us that an elf of great prestige in the eyes of the gods is about to pass from this life, that we might go and seek them. In this case it was the former Grand Master of the Inquisition, Aeldra. And my father was a soldier, and my mother was a hunter, so neither of them really ever paid much heed to the Inquisition, save for the one or two stories they'd heard about them being demon slayers that helped defend our city from the Dark Elves when they were very young. So they did not seek him out, and apparently them enjoyed one another's company instead. The tips of Andre's ears go slightly pink. In any event, I was born 9 months later, with my hair already as white as a woman reaching her 8th century. The priests saw it as a sign that I had been touched by Selhaedin, and naturally I was bundled off as soon as was possible to live under her priests, which also happened to include the Inquisition, whom watched me rather carefully. My childhood is really nothing much to speak about, so I will not, save for my mentor, Ilaedhm. He was quite young to already be training an apprentice, perhaps one of the most talented sorcerers and swordsmen of our time, though after meeting you, Peregrine, I believe he may be surpassed in time, she says, nodding to the diminutive swords master, who blushes. Luck helps, he says with a shrug, but still beams with pride. But yes, he was my mentor, though I never developed any real talent for magic. To his eternal disappointment, he remained and protected our city through the Soulmonger crisis, and once I had completed my training, he departed to try to learn what had caused the crisis, though it was 10 years past at this point. I continued in my service for the next few decades, mostly dealing with minor problems like an unhappy spirit or some imp that a human had let loose. She sighs. Then Ilaedhm returned, haggard and worn from his travels. He met in conference with his mother, who had become one of the highest members of both the Church and the Inquisition. Soon, those that they trusted were drawn into an inner circle. There he revealed what he had discovered while he was gone. The drow were on the move, in greater numbers than ever before. Worse yet, they had begun to abduct and replace members of elven cities to spy them out and destroy them from within. We were sworn to secrecy, and began to hunt them. The hunt went on for another 2 decades, capturing agents and striking down plots, until at last we had it, and it was more terrible than we could have ever imagined. Our king himself had been replaced, along with the highest members of our council. Elatum was beyond furious, and he personally took his guard and stormed the palace. His mother, already inside, flung open the gates, and Elatum and his followers wiped them out without mercy. I was away on another mission, but when I returned, it was to a city with Elatum for a king. For a moment, perhaps a month, it seemed that maybe he had done the right thing. I certainly had no time to process, but then he, and his mother, showed their true colors, and the horrific nature of our mistake became painfully clear. His mother was Iacol, a demonic servant of Loth that had infiltrated our ranks years ago. He was her true son, a half-demon who hid his true form beneath a mask. The drow attacked our city in force, and the traitor's council struck from within. She shudders. It was 3 days of constant fighting. 3 days where those of us still loyal fought against an army already within our walls. Only the intervention of a band of traveling adventurers and one of our oldest allies, a great silver dragon, saved the city and drove off the drow. Even still, many were taken captive, dragged underground never to be seen again, and Elatum went with them. She clenches her fist so hard that her nails break her skin. I survived the battle, though I cannot remember any of it. I could not allow it to haunt my trance and my dreams, so I cut that memory off and destroyed it. I departed not long after. I had been fooled like all the rest, but I could not face that city any longer, not after that. So, I traveled as far as I could away from it, until I came to the caravan. Undri says, absent-mindedly healing her hands as she brings an end to her tale. Damn, a fell tale. Ye didn't deserve that, lass, and that's a mighty grud to add to me list. Kazdor rumbles as he grinds the powdered silver with enough force that the pestle is also slightly ground. Julian raises an eyebrow. You have a list. And crimes against elves are added to it. Al has a very long list. 50,824 grudges committed against Clan Glaimdring and our friends. So plus one more towards this Elatum Skinner. And his demon mother Tabut, Kazdor snarls. Where in the nine hells have you been keeping a list that big? Julian asks incredulously. You need a tome bigger than my spellbook. We as a tome, but I memorized it, Kazdor says, and Julian's jaw drops. The dragonborn grins at the Asima. I'm not just a big lummox laddie. The capacity for dwarves to remember grudges is slightly better than a devil to remember the terms of a contract, Senkit says with a smile. I've met both, and the devil is a good few feet behind. The party laughs, except Kazdor, who sees that is an eminently reasonable and somewhat self-evident statement, which causes even Andri to chuckle slightly. Thank you, Kaz, she says, mood brightened by the dwarven born's inadvertent hilarity. Silver's ground by the way, lass. Right, excellent. In the basin, please. Everyone, weapons in it as well. Andri instructs, and the party places their blades in the basin as Andri sprinkles in the silver and begins to chant in Elvish. Unfortunately, nobody else can speak Elvish including me, so what exactly she says is beyond me. The water begins to glow like moonlight, and when the light fades, the weapons still carry that glow. There, we have until moonset and they'll be able to hurt the banshees more effectively. Wait, my swords are already a holy symbol, and so are Kaz's axes, Peregrine points out. Shouldn't they be effective already? Banshees are elven dead under an elvish curse. Dwarven and halfling gods have no power over them. It is at this point that Eort and Urike return, with unbuffed weapons. We found a safe path. Wait, what did you do to your swords? The party unilaterally facepalms as they realize they forgot about Eort and Urike, and now they're out of silver and water. Oh, and the sun is starting to go down. Well, damn and blast it. Eort, once you and Urike get us there, hang back. This is a blessing to grant our weapons power over the banshees so we can throw them back. Right, about that, good news and bad news. The good news is we found a safe path. The bad news is that it's going to take a while to get there. It'll be dark by the time we reach the glade. The even worse news is that the route goes under the graveyard, so there might be even more spooky nonsense. Great, more blight tentacles, Senkit sighs. Guess we better hurry up and get going then. The paladins hurry along the path, running through the sewers to get to the glade before it gets completely dark. As they run by, they jump across the water to the other side as they pass under the graveyard and can see the thick rubbery black vines breaking through the wall on one side. As they rush past, and leave the strange growths behind them. The vines shudder, and then again, like water in a glass, rippling at the passage of a great beast, so the vines shudder, to the footfalls of unseen blight. Be me, P. Castor, Andri, Senkit, Julian, Yort, and Peregrine, order undivided and paladins all. Led by Yurak the Dragon Shield, the party races by secret paths and sewer tracks to reach the Elven Glade to banish the Banshees from it and thus secure a new base of operations for their time in Zanj Jonas. By the time they catch their breath and move out through the manhole into the street next to the Elven Glade, the sun is low in the sky, turned dark violet at the falling of the day. While the full moon rises in the east, their weapons glow faintly in the dark, blessed while Selhadian still watches. Andri nods and turns to Kaz. The wax, she asks, holding out her hand. The dragonborn removes the candles, now partly melted due to his body head. Andri tears off two pieces and stuffs them into her ears to block out the sound. As to the others, thus deafened and protected, they enter the haunted glade. The eerie quiet is disconcerting. It is strange for Castor to not feel the grass and earth crumple and crack under his feet. Senkit looks at all the foliage and wonders if she would hear the chittering and chattering of the local fauna, much like the noisy jungles of her youth. Andri though moves with practiced care, blades drawn, not wishing to waste her magic ammunition until the need is great. Through the silent dark they walk, lit only by the moon above and the moon in their blades. The shadows swirl as the party turns this way and that to keep as many angles as possible under their field of vision. Past the narrow uninhabited barrier, they come to what was once the Elven Quarter. And like the rest of the city, this part is still very well preserved, undefiled by vine or by the ravages of orcs and gnolls. The houses still stand, each one growing out of the base of a tree, and others nestled in the boughs. They still live, for the elves do not lumber their beloved forests, but warp them with magic and song to their whims. Castor looks upon this and ponders, mildly impressed. The elves are not great builders, but to meld the living wood like his folk do the unliving stone is still worthy of his respect. Senkit taps him on the shoulder to get his attention. She conjures a small gout of fire in her palm, and then snuffs it out, shaking her head side to side. The dragonborn nods in understanding, there will be no fire this night. Andri looks for the tallest tree, the one with limbs that can bear up a shrine as close to the moon as possible and finds it. She waves to the others to follow and they set out. As they approach, they see two spectral figures dance across the path in each other's arms. At a distance it seems to be a pair of beautiful elven maids, but the party knows better and stands wary. The dancers stop as they see the party and turn. Their faces are as beautiful as starlight twinkling on a still pond. They smile at the party, saying something, but the party cannot hear them. They drift closer, gesturing for the party to come near. Andri braces herself, and Peregrine slips into the shadows. Julian sweeps the area for any others, and sees another approaching from the flank. Senkit though is having none of this, and simply walks towards the Banshees with her weapons at her sides. Kaz looks at her like she's crazy and starts to follow her. It's then that the Banshees make their move. The two in front rush forwards, unleashing their deadly wail, but it falls on deaf ears. Senkit crimson moves to engage, but Andri beats her to the punch. The Elven Inquisitor moves like a silver blur past them and closes on the unquiet dead. The Banshees loose their beautiful disguises, showing old, crin-like faces aged by unbridled hatred, rotting away in large chunks. Andri is unimpressed and cuts away at one with her glowing blade. The blessing bites into ectoplasmic flesh and tears the ghost apart. Andri follows through, driving it back with dagger and saber. Senkit closes on the next one, lashing out with her shield. The Banshee makes no effort to block, expecting the attack to go right through it, and is surprised when the blessed steel knocks the wind from her lungs, cutting off her deadly song and sending her sprawling while Senkit's mace pummels her into the floor. The third Banshee sees Julian coming, and dives under the ground, appearing behind him in the center of the party. She lets out her death cry, and then looks around confused as to why everyone is still alive. The cry turns into a rattle as Julian whirls and slashes apart her torso, leaving it a barely recognizable mess, before Yort's Gladius cuts off her head and silences her for good. A fourth Banshee approaches from above to ambush the group, but Peregrine is waiting for it. Leaping from his hiding place, the halfling drives a short sword into her ankle and drags her down. The ghost lashes out with an ethereal claw, but Peregrine cuts it off with a backhanded slash before reversing it to cut her across the chest. Kazdor moves in to support Undri, axes biting into the angry ghost. Despite its grave injuries, the Banshee weakly raises a hand to try to grasp at the Dragonborn's heart, before he rips his axes away and tears the creature into a fog of pale light that quickly fades. The Banshee sink it is quite literally beating into the ground sinks all the way into the ground to escape the infernal paladin, and then re-emerges behind her to lash out with a claw. Senkit whirls and parries it, leaving the ghost wide open. The tiefling bashes the ghost once in the stomach, dropping it to its knees. She then pulls back and delivers her Morning Star down on the Banshee's face and chest, painting ectoplasmic remains across the glade in a manner that would be highly gory if she was still alive. The paladins check one another and see that they've come through the encounter unscathed. They grin, their countermeasures are working perfectly. Undri points to the tallest tree in the glade. Nestled among its branches is a small building, the Shrine of Selhaden. The paladins nod and make for it. While they are unmolested on their path to the tree, they all feel increasing tension in the air, a certain swirling Suzaris building around them. It seems that their presence has been noted, and they are unwelcome. They rush for the tree and climb the stairs to the altar near its summit before the attack can come. They soon reach it, a simple altar of white wood nestled on the tree limbs, with a silver bow upon it. The bow gives off a faint hum of magic, though whether it is truly magical or simply a function of being part of the altar is uncertain. Undri kneels low by it, and removes one of her earplugs, motioning for the others to do the same. Right, this is the tricky part. It will take some time to activate the ritual, and I need my ears clear to perform it. I need the rest of you to keep the Banshees back until I open the door. Once the door is open, do not, and I mean do not, pass through it under any circumstances. It is a path for the dead, and if you enter it, you will die. And your soul will probably be thrown somewhere in the cosmos at random if it isn't obliterated outright for trying to enter our Vanda without permission. The party nods, acknowledging the risks. We'll keep them back, lass. Just get the door open. Kazdor promises, and the party nods in agreement. Outside they can see a swirl of ectoplasm building near the tree. The dead have come in force. At their head, one beautiful and more terrible than all steps into the clearing, drawing near, with her handmaids behind her. She is proud and tall, clad in noble dress with a crown of twisted silver upon her brow. On her finger is a ring that gleams with the cold light of hungry stars. She bears in one hand a mirror and in the other a long rapier. Where she steps, the grass is coated in frost, and the air is cold as winter nights about her. Her body is like a statue carved of glass, beautifully composed of cruel edges. A Banshee queen, greatest and most terrible of the elven shades, has come. Undri looks at the fell dead with grim determination and turns to the party. Go, I will bring an end to this. Moon watch you. The party nods and turns to go, and Julian is last to depart. And may your gods keep you safe, he answers her, before replacing his earplugs and descending to meet the foe. Undri turns to the altar, and begins a chanting prayer. The moon glows brightly, and the hum of the altar begins to intensify. The Banshee host arrays itself for battle. Seven stand in formation behind their queen, and perhaps 20 more, if not even greater numbers, swirl about the great tree, cutting off all escape. Deathly songs echo through the glade, and the light of the glimmering spirits outshines the moon, and the stars cannot be seen for the spectral pollution. The party steps forwards and blocks the queen's path as she approaches the tree. The ugliness of her spirit shines through a carefully crafted beautiful face. No illusion can conceal a wicked soul entirely. She looks at the party contemptuously and says something, but the party does not respond because they cannot hear her. She narrows her eyes, glaring at their moon-touched weapons, and raises her sword as she orders her handmaidens to attack. Peregrine is swifter than the dead, and takes a running leap from his position in the back to leap first onto Kazdor's shoulders, then off him onto the queen from an unexpected angle, throwing her back. His blades scrape her glassy form, leaving long scratches but no great damage. The handmaidens surge forwards to protect their queen, two swiping at the agile halfling who dives away from their attacks, the others rushing the main group of paladins. Yort vanishes from view as the Banshees swipe at empty air. The treacherous hobgoblin cackles in the night as he slips around them, moving around towards the queen. The Banshees press hard on the main line, staggering the Paladins back as ghostly claws slip through armor and leave the party breathless. Senki takes one step back, and then flares like the sun, bringing the light of dawn into the night as she rebukes the Undead, who fall back trailing golden fire. Julian sees the chance and sidesteps, turning to bring his great blade at full force into the back of the Banshee targeting Kaz, rending her asunder and giving the Dragonborn an opportunity to go for the Queen. Kaz recognizes this and charges into the batch around Peregrine, laying into the handmaidens with his axes blazing. The divine light rips one to pieces and scatters her remains across the grass. The Queen smiles as the two have entered into her reach, raises her mirror, and the mirror shatters, knocking the paladins to their knees as the vibrations threaten to shake their armor apart. Worse though, the sound cracks the wax seals on the paladin's ears, and the wax begins to fall, and they can hear again. Above in the tree, Undri's prayerful chant begins to build in strength. The moonlight begins to shine more brightly in the boughs, starting to draw attention from the spirits surrounding them, two of whom begin to approach. Peregrine realizes the danger he's in and moves fast. He moves away from the Queen, nearer to Kaz, and slashes at the Banshees near him, catching one in the knee to drop it, then driving his blades into the top of its head, a lucky hit, an act 20. Lucky used, and well timed, as the remaining Banshee near them opens her mouth. Kazdor and Peregrine's minds know only pain as the deathly wail rakes at their souls, and their visions flicker black. Even the mighty Dragonborn falls to a knee gasping, eyes watering and breath shallow. The scream is not simply a sound, but more akin to having an ocean of noise dropped on top of you. Despite this, he struggles to his feet, his ear slits, nose, and eyes all weep rivulets of blood, as do Peregrine's, but they have weathered the Banshee's cry. Now it is time for payback, as Kazdor pushes through the scream. With a great effort, he swings his axe and buries it in the Banshee's throat, cutting off the sound. As life surges back into his limbs, he rips down to carve open her chest before his second axe comes in and banishes the wicked dead. Senkit, wreathed in fire, throws back the Undead from Julian, swinging her mace and sending the ghost sprawling around her. She points upwards to the ones advancing on Undri, and he nods. The Arsimer's wings ignite and he soars into the sky, grey sword gleaming with raw power. The cold blue and indigo night turns briefly crimson as his power hits the Banshee from below, blasting her into pieces with a single devastating strike to her abdomen, an act 20. He flies from there towards the next, but is not quite able to reach her. The Banshee Queen moves in on the weakened Peregrine, icy rapier stabbing. He parries once, standing up weakly, but his haze lies still bright with defiant gleam. Her blade comes in again and is stopped by an unseen force. She looks confused at it quivering in the air, before Eort cloaks and strikes her across the face, lightning crackling around his gladius and throwing her back. She comes up with half her perfect face broken off, revealing the skeletal monster beneath. Peregrine advances, rolling his sword around hers to cut her on the wrist, flowing from that into a cut across her breast, while his other blade lunges and strikes a chunk from her glassy armor. It falls to the ground steaming like dry ice. Undri continues her ritual, it growing ever more intense and complex, but she is faithful, and her faith is reaping rewards as a white mist begins to form about and above the altar. Even as she chants, the other flying Banshee soars in to claim her. The Banshees turn from Senkit, splitting up. Some fall upon Eort and Peregrine, diverting their attention from the Queen. Eort takes a nasty blow as one slips through his armor and cradles his face in her hands. The hobgoblin's flesh begins to rot away at her touch before he can slip away. The others race for Kazdor, howling their dread wails. The Dragonborn's vision flickers, and he falls to a knee. Then all goes dark, and he slips into blackness. The thud as he hits the ground echoes throughout the glade. Julian watches Kazdor fall in silent horror, then looks to the Banshee flying for Undri. "I'm sorry," he says silently, as he turns from his fallen friend to protect the mission. The Warhawk descends with worldless vengeance and fury on his lips. The Banshee looks up and raises her arms to defend herself. It is futile. The Aquila blade falls and bites into her arms, and the enraged Arsimer floods it with power. Scarlet flashes in the night, eclipsing the grim light, and blasting the Banshee's arms from her body. Julian is not finished. He drives his sword through the Banshee's mouth as she opens it to scream, and then rips the shade in half lengthwise, drowning her out in his own bellow of rage. Senkit rushes to Kazdor's side, the light of her devotion smashing into the banshees around him like a freight train and hurling them away. She drops her mace and falls to a knee, turning the dragonborn over and holding his head up gently. Golden light flows from her hand into him, and he weakly opens his eyes. Senkit sighs in relief, and before he can protest, pulls the wax from her own ears and places it over his, telling him something he cannot hear. Kazdor struggles first to his knees, then to his feet as the power of the Dwarven gods bolsters him. The strength of Clangdeen, the indomitable endurance of Thamkal, the volcano god, and simple stubborn pride. And like a volcano, Kazdor burns with an inextinguishable fire as he forces his arms to raise his axes once more. "I will not be defeated by some shadow of an elf," he roars in Dwarvish, loud enough to shake the trees and make the banshees cover their ears. The massive dragonborn, visibly glowing with the heat of his fury, hits the retreating banshees like a bowling ball. One raises an arm to block him, but he cleaves through the arm and into her heart. Whirling to the next, he smashes the jaw from her face, as well as her upper torso from existence with an explosion of divine power, before turning to the third and cleaving her in two with a similar surge of power. As the dragonborn returns, Eort takes his payback for his rotted face. Moving in low, he strikes the banshee in the stomach, crackling with lightning. He throws her back and pursues, ducking under another strike and stabbing her under the armpit, discharging more power to finally put the thing down. While this progresses, the banshee queen becomes increasingly frustrated with Peregrine's refusal to get hit. Every time she gets close to landing a blow, he either swipes it away, or the grass slips slightly under him and spoils her attack by pure chance. She gathers her power and prepares a howl of rage to remove the small nuisance from her path when something stops her. That something is the sound of Undri, uttering the last few words of the incantation, and the sound of rushing wind as the mists form into a great gate of moonlight and glow brighter than the stars. The banshees are lifted up and hurled into the gate, vanishing into it. But the queen hangs on stubbornly, rapier driven into the ground to hold herself, before it slips and she flies screaming into the moon door. For a moment the paladins breathe a sigh of relief, before the banshee's scream comes back out through the moon door, and the mists turn black. Blight tendrils erupt from the gateway to the afterlife, wrapping down and around the great tree. In the distance, something stirs, as something senses life, and cold hatred blossoms. Back at the tree, the black and silver mists whirl in battle. Undri draws near, opening her mouth to speak and add her power to the ritual, when the queen, half her beautiful icy face gone, pulls herself back through the portal and seizes Undri by the throat, dragging her in after her. On the other side of the portal, Undri breaks free and faces down the banshee queen. All around them there is dark, the dark of a land without moon or stars, and they stand atop the corpse of a great tree. Above them, a portal of swirling moonlight beams, with the lesser banshees straining for it, but bound, each by their throat, to a chain. Chains that lead back to the mirror in the hand of their queen. "They will not abandon me. You shall not betray me. I am your queen, and you will protect me. The blight will not claim me," the deluded ghost raves at Undri, gesturing wildly with her sword. "You are mine. They are mine. All of it is mine," she hisses, struggling for the portal back to the real world. Undri stands between her and that gate, and she draws her swords, gleaming mercilessly with the Inquisitor's light. "You are dead," she tells the ghost calmly. "It is time for you to pass on. Be gone from this realm or I shall make you be gone," she says, amethyst eyes cold and impassive. The banshee howls in response, and Undri's vision flickers, but even as blood weeps from her eyes and ears, she raises her blades. "Then perish," she responds, and attacks. The Inquisitor's blades meet the queen's rapier in a flurry of sparks, and Undri lunges on. She cuts the queen across her face, further cracking the icy illusion, and smashes aside more of the ice on her chest and shoulder. The queen curses her and raises the mirror, which shatters again, the sound slamming into Undri. But the elf is buoyed by the blessings of the ancients, rooted into the foundations of the world, and it washes over her like waves on a tall stone. On she comes again, saber waxing like the crescent moon to strike the mirror from the queen's hand, then waning back to strike her again. The queen meets it with her rapier, so Undri drives her dagger into the queen's elbow, then twists, A great rhythmic thudding sound grows louder as the unknown thing grows closer in the dark. In the distance, a great figure begins to approach, a running silhouette the size of the tree they stand upon, a black hole in the shape of a gigantic horned man. The paladins on the other side see a strange phenomenon. Patches of grass wither and die, in intervals much like the footprints of a titan. Upon this plane of the dead can suffer, and can bleed, and so the Banshee Queen bleeds as the walking knight draws close. She pulls away and lunges twice more. The first strikes Undri above the heart, and frost forms on her breast there. The second, Undri lunges beneath, coming up and driving both her blades into the spirit's abdomen. Close enough to kiss her, Undri looks into the mad ghost's eyes. By my authority as a member of the Maker's Most Holy Inquisition, I release you. She says, and the chains fall away. Be purified by rebirth in the Creator. She blesses the spirit, even as it cracks like a damaged mirror, and never return to haunt the living. You are banished from death, she sentences the queen, and rips her blades out. The Banshee Queen shatters like a glass figurine cast upon the flagstones, and Undri dives for the portal as the monster of Walking Night reaches out a massive claw to seize her. The paladins watch as Undri breaks out of the portal, and then as a huge claw made of pure darkness follows her through and seizes the great tree. In less than a heartbeat, the tree dies. Black rot spreads across it like wildfire, its needles fall like rain and its branches wither. No longer able to hold up the shrine, the bout, and Undri fall. Julian dives in, catching her and flying free as the portal snaps shut, severing the hand, which turns to black mist and blows away in an unseen wind. As they land, the tree creaks its death groan, and then falls, splintering all the way down and crashing, so that it more resembles dust than timber or even splinters. It's over, the glade is safe now, Undri says relieved as Julian sets her down. Maybe, the Arsima says as he looks up at where the tree was. But what in the nine hells was that?